A very busy autumn public program here at the AA. I'm pleased to start the week with Vittorio Lampugnani's lecture this evening. Vittorio joins us, and some of you will know him from the last couple of years as an external examiner with us here at the school, and it's a great pleasure to have him in this evening to do a lecture. His title for the evening is The Craft of Urban Design, and his position, which of course many of you will know, a very carefully drawn position that sees urban design as neither an art nor, strictly speaking, a science, but in fact a kind of craft that demands both tacit knowledge of the city we know and projective ideas to take cities forward. One of the, I would say, great ironies of an era of rampant urbanization is an almost complete and total, indeed universal, loss of faith in the idea that design as we know it can operate at the scale of the city. Urban design is one of those great disciplines like sociology that you could say for 20 or 30 years has been continually eroded as particularly architectural cultures have focused on the architectural object and the singular experiences of buildings. It seems the entire world believes in the capacity to design at the scale of these funny things. And strangely, the deep and in fact European discipline of the city as a design project is something that you could say is under reconsideration. I think Vittorio would take a very different view. And in fact, his longtime experience and expertise lies in understanding the way in which the history of urban design, and particularly the European experience of urban design, can provide the basis for new and imaginative ways of reconsidering the making of new cities today. Vittorio is a longtime teacher, an educator in the field, and not only a practitioner. His own works are in fact demonstrations of ideas and theories that I think many of you will already be aware of. I think his campus in Basel for Novartis, for the pharmaceutical giant Novartis that has in consistently over the last decade or longer brought some of the world's great architects together to realize projects is one of the fields that you can say Vittorio has tested his ideas in. His recent Richti-Quartier near Zurich, which is a new neighbourhood of residential, office, commercial, and public program spaces, is another example of his work that tests and pushes forward ideas that he has long taught and delivered as an expert in the field. And I think in a way you could say Vittorio is an example of this sort of super Europeanism of urban design itself in the world today. Again, one of the striking features of this current wave of globalization, while the world builds new cities at astonishing speeds and scales never before seen on the planet, is that in fact it is an incredibly European project right now. Europeans in all kinds of forms, usually as consultants, but often as active professionals and master planners, are undertaking that work to a very great extent from here to the far corners of the planet. And you could say in a way the deep European experience of urbanization is one reason why the interest and ideas of Vittorio matter so much within the field. He is currently professor of the history of urban design at the ETH in Zurich. He's a former dean of that school. Has been a professor in Salzburg in the Department of Architecture at Harvard's Graduate School of Design, a fellow at the Institute for Advanced Studies in Berlin, former director of the Architecture Museum in Frankfurt, and former editor of Domus magazine in Milan, and maintains a practice in Switzerland and in Milan. Spends his time between the two, and since 1980 has carried forward projects as a practitioner and not only historian, theorist, and educator. Please join me in welcoming Vittorio Lampugnani.
Thank you very much, Brett, for this very kind introduction and obviously for the invitation. Thank you for joining me and us here. I think, first of all, I have to, I'm very happy actually to be here at the AA because I find it a very interesting school, a school with which I have been connected in irregular intervals for quite a long time. So I'm very happy to be in a way here again. I would, as you can see, the title of my small talk, short talk, I will check a little bit, is The Craft of Urban Design Reinvented. I think I have to justify that. Well, part of it is due to my rather rudimentary English, which you can hear. Part of it is, it has to do with the fact that, yes, I consider urban design, or I like to consider urban design as a craft, so not as an art, definitely not as an art, and also not as a science, even if I think that the systematization of knowledge is very important for urban design, probably more than for for architecture, even if I consider it important for architecture too. And reinvented is a bit pompous, I admit. What I meant is that it has to be re-established, reconstructed, replaced, that it needs to be rediscovered, it has to have importance again, it has to have a weight again, and in order to attain this, it has, in a way, to look at the past, at its own past, which is a kind of thesaurus, almost, of possible strategies that are far from being something that you can imitate. They are, I think, the most important critical instrument that we have that allows us to go beyond the images of architecture, but especially of urban design, into the meaning of what we are doing. You may say, why? What is the necessity of urban design? Where is, let's say, the case for urban design? Let me show you just a few images of probably the country that has a more disciplined and orderly way of dealing with this territory, which is Switzerland, of course. I'm not Swiss, so I can I can say these things. I would like to show you just the images of a place. I mean, this is all very strategic because we'll go back to this place at the end of the lecture. It's very near Zurich. It's a bit outside of Zurich. This is the situation in the middle of the 19th century. As you can see, it's Wallisellen, and it's really a small village. This is the situation in the 80s of the 19th century. You see, it's still a small village. The only difference is that the map is a bit larger, and as you can see here, the railway. That's the new thing that has happened. This is the situation in the 20s, and you can see of the 20th century now, and you can see, well, it's still a small village. And this is the situation now. And you can see, of course, that it's not a small village anymore, but it's also not a city yet. It's just a kind of complete urbanized territory. And I take this example, but of course I could take any example. All over Europe, and you should consider Switzerland is one of the, as I said, it's really objectively one of the countries more disciplined in terms of urbanization, but that means that every second in Switzerland, one square meter is built by something, not by a street or by a house or by something. The rate in Italy, I don't know in Britain, the rate in Italy is 10 times that. So we are talking, I think, of something that I would define as a problem, and that we need to in some way to face. This is just, let's say, the territorial question. There is also the question of contents. I would like to show you just the two images of the main square. This is not Valizen, this is Wollerau, which is nearby. This was the main square of Wollerau, and you see the schools went, the school children went there and had parties, and it was a kind of community. And this has been changed, this is the situation now. This was in the 60s, actually. It was not ages ago. It's a photograph of 68. And this is the situation now. So you see this infrastructure has taken the place of the square and obviously has destroyed not only the square, but also the buildings around it. This hotel doesn't work anymore. The cafe doesn't work anymore. So it's also a destruction of, I'm not talking about architecture, or not only about architecture, also of a social structure. Why is it so, or what should we do about it? Let me tell you the story of urban expansion in the 19th and 20th century. This is a story that one, or that I learned at school. It's a story of the city of the 19th century, the very dense, unhealthy, poor, city. This is an image of London, which you probably know by Gustave Doré of 1872. It is called a street in Whitechapel. He has painted a lot of, engraved a lot of this rather shocking image, and there are many, many of such, such pictures. The best descriptions of the situation is probably what Friedrich Engels has done in his description of London, Manchester, and so on in the 19th century. Then, vis-à-vis this, this situation, comes the big alternative. This is an image, actually it was done for the for promoting Hampstead Garden suburb. It's called The Choice. And you can see here the worker who has to choose. And he has to choose between the old city, over which hovers a rather unpleasant old lady. I don't know if you can read it, it's disease and misery. or this line of cottages, which somehow are a prefiguration of Hampstead Garden suburb, over which an attractive young lady is flying, and she's called Health. And then there is a caption, or there is a small text saying, what will he choose? But of course, it's a pretty rhetorical question. And this comes, of course, with, and then comes, of course, or a little bit before, 1898, Ebenezer Howard does this beautiful sketch, actually, of the Garden City, writes his famous book. This is a sketch that he did himself, very nicely colored. And it's, of course, the idea of the Green City, of Letchworks, the first Garden City here in a drawing showing the cottage, the nature, and the healthy girl coming back from playing from playing tennis, and it's the health of the country and the comforts of the town. And in a way, this was the alternative to the old, historical, massive, unhealthy, really unhealthy, I mean, really disastrous city. And the idea was really that the city would be abandoned, that this was the alternative, that, and it was a strategy of, let's say, of urbanization as an alternative to the historical city. And this has developed a little bit everywhere, even in Zurich. This again, Zurich, this is Schwammendingen, the Swiss or the Zurich garden city. It's not a real, I mean, Howard would have been horrified because it's not a real garden city, it's not independent, it's part of the town. It's very late, actually, it's in the 40s. It was designed and built in the 40s. Looks like this. And it's not unattractive, I have to say. It has, it's, its qualities. But of course, this idea of this cottage, the single house, then materializes in Levittown, between 47 and 51, by the notorious Levitt brothers. The first mass-produced suburb. I think they did 3 houses per day, which is quite amazing. a very reactionary program. Only white people could rent or buy a house here, and but extremely successful. This is the first one that I'm showing to you. it was done in on Long Island near New York. And then different others followed in Philadelphia and so on. And here, of course, this idea, this original, also social idea of the garden city is completely perverted, and leads to to what Victor Grün then designed, or let's say criticized Victor Grün, the inventor in a way, or the main protagonist of the shopping mall story. He somehow converted after building the biggest shopping malls all over the United States, and he he used this cartoon to show what suburbia really was doing with this machine which eats the trees and produces these houses set in nice rows. And the result, of course, is suburbia. I mean, these are images that could be anywhere. They are in Zurich, but it doesn't really matter, because this is then this kind of house that remains affordable. These are the gardens that spread around the cities. These are the infrastructures that are necessary in order to serve all these suburbs. And these are the the endeavors, in a way, to turn this suburbia into eine Stadt, into a city. This is the situation that we have. I mean, I took Switzerland as an example. I could have taken Italy or Germany or Britain. but let me tell you another story of modern urban extension, exactly the same time frame. So again, it starts, I spare you another image by Doré. It starts with, you know, with a terrible situation of the 19th century, like, for instance, Barcelona, which was one of the most unhealthiest city in the middle of the 19th century of all Europe, probably the densest city, much denser than Paris, or London, of course, and a real disaster. And in Barcelona, after tearing down the walls, the government decides to have a survey by a young engineer from Madrid. His name was Ildefonso Cerdà. And Cerdà makes this survey. This is a situation. This is, you can see here, the old city of Barcelona, which he didn't draw because that was not his commission. And he did a very precise survey of a rather large area, actually. This is about 7 kilometers here, and this is about 4 kilometers. But instead of doing only a survey, which was his commission, he did also a plan that was not commissioned to him. He did one in 1855, which is lost, and then reworked it a little bit later in 59, and this is the plan, the plan of 59. And you see what he did basically is he, like Howard, like all the reformers, he considered the historical city something that was lost. He didn't even almost didn't touch it. Well, he did this. He cut through this this three roads that you can see. he would have liked to tear it down, but he was not allowed to. So he said, "Okay, we do it around it because the people will leave it anyway. They will not want to live there." But around it, he designed the new Barcelona, which was. Not dissimilar to a garden city. You can see that the blocks were built normally on two sides. This is the dark spot, and in the middle you have to imagine a garden. But of course the blocks are blocks, the streets are streets. He creates it through cutting the edges, something like almost 90 small squares all spread all over. The city, and a very interesting plan because it's a completely homologous city, and being a Marxist, this was also kind of ideological, let's say, framework for a new society. And this is Barcelona as you know it. I will spare you the whole history of the implementation of the plan, which is quite impressing and interesting. of course, it was built completely in a completely different way, with about 10 times the density that that Cerdà wanted. But the old historical city was kept, as you can see here. But it grew as a city. It was a city extension, but it grew as a city as a compact. As we all, I think, acknowledge, quite a beautiful city. Let's take another example, because Cerdà made a very good plan and a very, very sophisticated plan. Let's take a more normal plan. this is Berlin in the middle of the 19th century. You can see here the medieval city. This is the Baroque extensions. And all what you see here in color, these lines, are part of a plan that was drawn by James Albrecht in 1862 for the extension of Berlin. Berlin was a rather small city at that time, had about 300,000 people, but it was clear that it would develop into a city of around 2 to 3 million people. So it was an incredible explosion, in a way, of the city. Albrecht drew this plan, which is not a good plan, let's face it, but it's also not so bad. In terms of urban design, you could start criticizing it very easily because the streets are too wide, some structures are completely non-realistic, it's pretty boring in some places. But if you compare it with Berlin as it was built, Berlin was, again, there was the city extension. You can see here the Baroque city. But the rest is all extension of the 19th century. And it is an extension of a city of partially also quite a beautiful city. You can say, okay, this was the city of the Mietskaserne, of the exploitation of the workers, of horrible living condition. This is a very famous photograph of Meiershof in the Ackerstraße in Wedding, the most cruel example of the exploitation of the soil and and the workers, a series of six courts, very narrow, very damp. but at the same time, in this very same plan, buildings like Alfred Messel's block on Sigingerstraße existed, which is quite nice courtyard with a very pleasant living situation, up to very beautiful situations like Rina's Hofgarten. It was done actually not by an architect, but by a builder, very simply, who opened up the block and created this kind of inner street, almost, with this small inner square in the block, and it's still existent and still still very very nice. So what I'm trying to argue is there are these two parallel history, and there is no reason why we should think that one history is the right history, no, the one with the garden city and the low density, and the other the wrong history. Especially, there is no reason why we should not be able to reconnect ourselves to this kind of strategies, to the strategy of Cerdá, to the strategy of Hobrecht, and create city extensions that are dense, that are not suburban, that are really parts of the city. I think that in order to do this, the knot of all this are, in my view, the public spaces. You can say we want density. There are many reasons to say we need density for the new city expansion, also not to consume, all the landscape or the rest of the landscape that we have. But in order to create, a compatible density, a pleasant density, an attractive density, you need to design good public spaces. And I think we have a little bit lost the capability of designing good public spaces. We are trying to work with our students. I have to stay in my place. To work with our students, we want them to make analysis of public spaces, it's an analysis in a way trying to understand them, but also trying to understand the design process of how they did. Let me show you just two examples of how we proceed. One you know pretty well, and I show it deliberately. It's Bedford Square, because since you know it pretty well, the methodology can be made quite clear. First, we try to, the students have to draw a plan of 1 to 10,000 without any specifications, which shows the situation, or let's say the situation of the public space in the city fabric. And I find it quite interesting that Bedford Square is almost not to be recognized in the fabric of the city. It's just somewhere. No, it's just spared out of a series of structure. We always have an image to understand how it is. Then we go nearer. And we draw it 1 to 2,000, and that's the moment when we start measuring the square, trying to find out the proportions of the square, so of the open space, to the height of the buildings. There is a little bit of history, I can't help it, of course, there's always a little bit of history, but only the necessary bit to understand how it came about and why it was done. We were interested in showing these projects really like projects. They are historical projects, but the students should follow the rationality, the reasons that led the planners of Bedford Square to do it as it is. And then we go more into detail. That's 1 to 500. We try to understand how the houses touch the square, how they open to the square, and up to the floor plans, and up to details in terms of materiality, in terms of the way the paving is done, in terms of this smaller detail. And it's not just a way to understand how Bedford Square looks like, but it's a way to understand how it came about and what its qualities are. And we do not encourage anybody to imitate Bedford Square, but we do encourage everybody to follow, let's say, the methodology of this kind of design, starting from a ratio and going up to the detail. Another example, Via Roma in Turin, same methodology, the city fabric, Here, of course, the structure of the Viroma is much more is much clearer because it's really the connection between two two important squares of Piazza Castello and here and the station. We go a little bit more into detail, show really the facade. This is a completely different situation, obviously, because Viroma is a is a big speculation that was done between, let's say, 25 approximately and 35. It's a kind of mega structure, actually. The basement is connected. You can see it here, but it has very fine. It's an operation led by Marcello Piacentini, who led basically all operations in Italy during fascism. But it's quite refined, and if you look at the proportions of the street and the arcade, and the proportions of the arcade, and if you look how this was connected with the new infrastructure, so the subway, and how the arcade is played with, it is a moment where students, and not only students, but also architects, I think can learn what I would call the craftsmanship of urban design. These are just two examples. We select in some way all the a sample of case studies that we consider somehow typical and relevant for a square, for a residential square, a more public square, a more representative square, for the functions that you have in the city. Let me now show you two projects, some aspects of two projects. I will not do a presentation of my own project, where we tried to apply and also to experiment in a way. Those were some kind of experiments that we were lucky enough to be able to do in scale 1-to-1 in the city. The first is, Brett has mentioned it already, the campus for Novartis in Basel, very simple or very common situation. It's this lot here, more or less, along the Rhine in the northern parts of part of Basel. It used to be a production site of Sandoz. On its way to being transformed into a place of research and administration, because the production was slowly going away. When I say was, I'm talking about the year 2000. That's when we started doing this project. And this was the situation that we found. So pretty chaotic. Old buildings, new buildings, put wherever they happened to be put. There was a port here. That was completely untouchable for the river. And yes, that was the situation. We started to look at what the plant used to be. This is the plan of the plant, which I found pretty interesting. And this was the architecture of the plant. When I showed this image or this project in our school, I got very much attacked by the students because I said, why didn't you keep these beautiful buildings? And they were right, of course. We didn't keep them because they were gone. When we started to work, they had turned everything down and built some rather ugly 60s, not all, but some very ugly 60s building. And we would have liked to be able to do something like this. Of course, everyone would like to do something like this. This is the center of Rome in the plan of Nolli. We know exactly that nobody will be able to do it. This is the product of centuries of the work of the best architects of their time. But what I was interested in, and beyond the patriotic reasons that make me love this plan, in this system, in this very fine system of public spaces, in some way, Nolli pretends, of course it's not really true, but Nolli pretends that the system of public spaces that he shows in white, including the churches and including the courtyards of the palaces that you can see here, which made sense because at that time it was really public. try to enter now, but at the time they were really public. he pretends that this system is a kind of generator of the urban fabric. It is not exactly true, but we thought, why don't we make it true? Why don't we try to do this? We had a very beautiful brief. The brief was transformation of a place of production into a place of research administration, so there was a change of scope. they wanted an attractive space, also because they wanted to be able to attract the best scientists to Basel, giving them a nice environment. And they were completely obsessed with the idea of, so we shared this obsession, of having a place fostering communication, interaction, innovation, and creativity, because I learned that scientific research, at least in life sciences, is not done anymore by single people or in very small group, but they have really big teams working on the same problem. And they are absolutely dependent on interaction and communication in the team, because otherwise they just double the work. And we translated it, biased of course, in six points. We wanted to have a high building density, also because I think that you need high building density, but of course creating spaces that were unshaded. We wanted to have natural light in all workspaces. We wanted to have functional buildings and functional public spaces. This looks like a cliche, but it is not. Public spaces, I think they need to be designed as buildings. So starting with a brief, starting with a program, trying to understand what happens on these public spaces, and then only then translating it into a design. Of course, flexibility, that's the magic word for everybody. And we wanted to do it not by buildings that can be changed, because buildings are not changed, but by creating pretty small and pretty neutral building. That was a big success, I have to say, because while we worked, there was not, of course, they had then a program, they had users, they had user requirements, and so on, but there was not one single building that was occupied by the people that the building was meant to be occupied. Because, but it's also logical, because such a firm is pretty dynamic. A building takes 3 years to be planned and built, and in 3 years many things change. We wanted to have functional, centralities for casual encounters, and we wanted to create a piece of identity. This is the very first sketch that we did. This is the same mounted into the structure of Basel. You see, originally it was a part of Basel, it was outside of Basel, now it's part of the city. And we wanted to create, to give it a completely different, wanted to be part of the city, but we wanted it to have a different grain, no? A different texture of the city, much denser. And we started to look at, we started with the public spaces, and we started, of course, with a very famous and beautiful public, or what we consider beautiful and very functional public spaces. So it's Plaza Mayor in Madrid, so it's Rue de Rivoli. We're not exactly modest. No, we are modest, but I think you have to aim very high. You have to take really the best examples, knowing that you will never attain them, of course. And this is the plan, the first plan that we developed, and everybody thought this is really extremely boring. And we got very bad reviews in the Neue Zürcher Zeitung, and we got very bad reactions in the company. They said, my God, I mean, everybody said, I could have done it too. It is partially true, but not quite, because if you look at it, it is not so banal. We decided to have one entrance, for instance, here, we decided to have one axis here crossing this other existing axis. Actually, these are two existing. This is Fabrikstraße, so it's the old street of the plant. And this is Hüningerstraße, which was a very important public street. I have to say was, and I will explain in a minute why. And then in between, we created, along this this Fabrikstraße, we created a sequence of three squares. So this is called the Forum, this is called the Green, and this is called the Piazzetta, ending up in this space, in this here. Actually, incidentally, this is the border to France, which makes it an interesting place also in that respect. And in between, and we said we want to create a very dense situation, so we want to put the buildings as close together as possible. As close together is 10 meters. That's the width of a street. Big protest. We can't do a street of 10 meters. We modeled it through the computer. We found out that if the buildings are only 23 meters high, which we wanted because that's below the so-called high-rise regulation in Switzerland, then you get natural light also on the ground floor. And the buildings are quite small. The widths vary between 18 and 30 meters, and the lengths between 50 and 60 meters. So they're pretty pretty small. And we tried to give every building, at least at one side, as a kind of compensation to this density, at one side the view to a place, an alley, or a small park, or one of those squares. And again, as compensation to this kind of density, we decided to create a big park here and a big park here. The politicians were quite happy with the parks, but not with the fact that we destroyed the port and that you cannot publish this because the port will stay at least for 100 years. That was 2000. 3 years later, it was 50 years. 5 years later, it was 20 years. And 6 years later, they started dismounting the port to put it in the logical place, which is about here, where there is already a port, which makes a lot of sense in terms of infrastructure. It was clear from the very beginning that this was a long-term plan, so we couldn't do it as an architectural plan. We needed to produce a set of rules that would, in a way, hold the whole thing together in a long period and in processes that we were not able to control fully. So we gave the streets names, so they were not ABC like in the plant, but real names of people contributing to the advancement of life sciences, including Asclepius. And we decided where the facades should be. So all what you see in yellow would be the main streets, and the rest would be more service streets. The streets were very important. This is the situation of one of the streets. It was a plant, no? So this was the character of the streets. And it was one of the first things that was changed, transformed into something like this. So in real urban streets with trees, with sidewalks, and with a lot of bicycles, which is nice. The whole thing was meant to be an almost pedestrian campus. I say almost because taxis were allowed to get in, limousines were allowed to get in, small delivery trucks were allowed to get in. I don't believe in the complete banishment of cars, but a lot of people use. We were lucky; it was very well served by public transport. This was already there, a lot of people use bicycles in Basel, so it was even more. And as you can see here. When I say we, this is not pluralis majestatis, as you might presume, but it's a quite correct grammatical form, because I was lucky enough to be able to create a working group with different disciplines. So there was a graphic designer, there was an art specialist, there was a lighting specialist, there was a landscape architect, and we really worked at this plan together, which I think is very important, so that, you know, art or the gardens didn't come in later somehow, but became part of the plan. So this is the team at work. You can see we had a hard time, and these are some of the results of the parks that were done by Peter Walker or by Günter Vogt. The art, this is a sculpture that Richard Serra designed for this very place. He was enthusiastic because this is the border to France, which I mentioned afterwards, and he was interested in this place. And I was very happy because for me it was the point de vue at the end of Fabrikstraße, so we came to immediately to an agreement, and it's a very nice sculpture. this is an idea of Alan Fletcher, who wanted to transform the fence that was absolutely necessary because there was still production going on, so quite dangerous stuff, from something, you know, keeping out into something interesting and that would make everybody curious. And this is the lighting that was there was also a lighting master plan for the whole. For the whole campus. And this is one of the drawings that we produced for the public spaces, for the streets, designing all the sidewalks and the streets. This brought us a lot of derision, of course, because we were so obsessed, which is partially right and partially justified, but the derision, but partially not, because at the end, what really holds the campus together are this public space. I'm very happy that they are all the streets are all the same material, all the same structure, all the same grid, all the same stones, up to the names of the streets that we carved into the sidewalks. I mentioned that the plan that we knew we couldn't control the plan completely. It's not true. The plan we could control, but it changed a lot. I show you only a few stages, there are many more, because the needs of the company changed, the aspiration of the company changed. So we had to somehow to react to all this while keeping the main principles intact. And this is the plan as it stands, the official plan as it is now. It is changing already. Again, the most painful change was this, that Hüningerstraße, which was our Broadway now, which was a public street, and I completely underestimated this situation, I would say, politically, because I thought a public street, it will always stay. It will not. They bought it, and the city complied, and so it was gone. And so we were really forced, I have to say, to cancel this street and to change the master plan, which is really a pity. I think it's a loss. But I also think that such a plan must have the strength, or if you want, the rigidity, to survive these losses without losing everything. In fact, then we tried to convince the client to keep a few buildings. They are not fantastic buildings, but they are not bad buildings. They have a good substance. So we did this plan that includes in dark the buildings that we would like to keep for good, and in yellow the buildings that we would like to keep medium term, which makes it, I think, also a nice variety and brings in a thin thread of history into this situation where history has been erased in at least three stages. So this is the situation basically as it is now. No, this is the situation as it is now, and it shows the nice thing. The nice thing is that they built a lot, and that Fabrikstraße is 700 meters long, and it's built as a street, which makes me very proud. The bad news are that all this became a kind of collection of architectures and of architects and of architectures. And I, of course, tried, and I had set very few rules. So the rules were the alignment of the buildings, the height of the building, 23 meters, and an arcade, a symmetrical arcade, like in the Rue de Rivoli, along Fabrikstraße, to show that this would, that this should be the main axis, and also in functional terms, people should be really walking up and down, which they do. That works nicely. For this arcade, every single architect invented a good reason why he or she would not want to do it. I mean, it was really the only architectural feature that we didn't say anything about the windows, about the materials, about nothing. But this arcade was a disaster. But this I kept, and so everybody made an arcade, more or less. And it's a nice space, and it's a very useful space because people can really walk up and down also in bad weather. For the rest, the buildings are really very heterogeneous. I will not go into that. I will just set the problem. But if you look at the names, you can imagine everybody comes, you know, with his idea and also with his ego. I mediated quite a lot. I was like, what I really could do was what the Magistri Viarum did in the Rome of the 14th century, preventing the architects or the owners to build into the street. No, because everybody had not enough space, so they wanted to push their buildings into the street. There was one architect, I will not tell names obviously, who wanted to have skylights popping up in the street, in the middle of the street, because he had a room underneath. So this I could prevent, but I could not prevent, of course, everybody doing, you know, his own thing. I mean, it's in between, it's still in between a city and a piece of a city and a collection of architecture, so a kind of architectural exhibition in the scale one to one. And you can maybe imagine how important it is that really the streets are all the same, because they are the grid, the streets and the squares are the grid that keeps the whole thing together. And this is one of the squares. This is the entrance, the Forum, the entrance square, that you can see it works very nicely, and it's one of these public spaces that we design in a very simple simple way. The second project that I briefly would like to show you is the Richti. In the Richti, the Richti was in a way more difficult but also more simple. It was this site here. And now you see why I showed you Wallisellen, because we are in Wallisellen. Everything comes down to, comes full circle. this is the station of Wallisellen. this was the area. It's about a little bit more than 7 hectares. Novartis is 25 hectares, so it's much larger. it belonged to one owner, a developer. the situation is quite dramatic, as you can see. This is the highway. This is a high-speed street. This is a shopping mall. This is another shopping mall. This is a station. This is a railway. And what you don't see but has been built and was clear that it would be built is a tram going about this direction here on a viaduct. So you wouldn't say that there is not enough infrastructure in this in this site. It was a competition. And our concept was the competition, but the program was good. The program was 40% residential, 60% offices, which is 50%, 50-50 would have been better, but it's still okay. Shops and a public in the public park. We decided not to do the public park, or to be more precise, to include the public park in the interior of the quarter, because it was too small to do a park. And all around here, it's really noisy because also this street here, which is Industriestraße, is also very, very heavy traffic street. So this was the concept. this was the competition entry, which is a collage, as you can see, of the green by Lenné. This is Le Nôtre. The plans are by Kai Fiske and Bruno Taut. So we stole from everywhere. Deliberately, we wanted to do a collage and show that we are very interested only in the urban form right now. We did a lot of mistakes. For instance, these blocks open to the railway would have been a disaster because of the noise. But we won the competition nevertheless. So the others were even worse. And the principle that we tried to clarify was to have a very clear distinction between the public realm, so the street that we wanted to be urban. Again, we used some of you may recognize it improperly, the architecture of Fernand Pouillot. And in the interior, however, we wanted to have this park, so we wanted to have this green. So we wanted to create a kind of different, very clear-cut differentiation between the, let's say, the more intimate spaces in the interior and the more public spaces on the streets. Eventually it changed like that. So the street grid has remained because it connects the most important points. This is the station. This is the station of the tram, of this tram that I told you about. And this is a bus station and the entrance to the shopping mall, which is a very successful shopping mall. So this was the master plan. And again, here we really started with the public elements, with the urban elements. So for instance, the residential streets, these were the residential streets. We looked for references. This is Milan, across the corner of where we live. This is the street section. We tried to make it very precise. You see, we tried also to make a very narrow street. It's only six meters because we don't want cars there or only a few. This was the first image. At the very beginning, it was not clear who would build what. It was still all open. Then we defined the main axis, so the Rue de Rivoli of the situation. We looked at the arcades. This is again Torino. As references, we designed a street that is also pretty narrow, 16 meters. It's the only street where cars can drive, although at only 30 kilometers per hour, so very slow. And this was the image that we began with. And then we said we want it to be a neighborhood, we want it to be a quarter of the city, so we want a place of gathering. And again, very modestly, we looked at Place Dauphin. Place Dauphin was much too large for our small thing, so we did it. It's still a triangular place, but it's just one third of Place Dauphin, and we designed it very, very simply. Basically, it's open. It has a few trees. It has a fountain. Doing a fountain nowadays is almost impossible, but I will not tell you the story of the fountain, which cost me the best years of my life. And this was the image that we produced. And this is the result. This is one of the streets of the. It's just finished. Right, it was finished last week. So I don't have good photographs. This is one of the residential streets. This is the main street. You can see we have even cars parking, and the trees are very small, but they will grow. And this is the famous square with the fountain that doesn't work, or doesn't work properly. But at least it's there, which is already a lot, a big success. What you also can see is that there are already shops and bars, and that is that the whole thing is alive. It has quite a high density. It's about 1,800 people living there, and about 2,500 people working there, plus the shops. We did it with as a group of architects, of course, we decided that the blocks should be distributed between different architects. But this time we didn't want to have another campus of Novartis, another collection of architects. So we were able also to convince the client, it's a developer, I mean, this is a purely commercial operation, what I am showing here. We convinced the developer to take architects, mostly architects, that in a way are related or have a connection to the city. So this is Max Dudler, this is Villares, who is not so connected to the city, but it's okay. This is Roger Dina, this is us. So we installed workshops. So we met regularly with a big model, with a big working model. Everyone would bring his own project, and there was a nice scene one time. Again, I didn't make any rules besides the building alignment and the height. So the materials were free, the windows, the size of it was all free. Not because I don't like unity. I like unity very much, I must tell you. That's why I like London so much. But I think it's very arbitrary nowadays to decide this is the material. Now, if you are in Bath in the 18th century, you take limestone, because limestone is very inexpensive and there's a quarry there and it's logical to use it. Nowadays, where the stone from China is cheaper than the stone that you quarry in the neighborhood, it's very difficult to make a formalistic decision, so I didn't want to make it. But we had these workshops, and we really tried to make the projects talk to each other. There was a nice scene of an architect coming in with his models, putting into the big model, looking, big silence. He said, "No, doesn't work," and taking it away. He did everything himself. I didn't say a word. It was a kind of self-regulating process where the projects, including ours, of course, we did also a block, were modified, but were modified not by somebody like me saying, no, this is not a good project. It was modified collectively, which was a really very pleasant and for me, but I think also I can speak also for the colleagues, enriching process. We did also a block as a kind of model block, very simple residential residential block. We worked a little bit with differentiation of facade, because the client was desperate, because we draw all the same facade all over the block. We drew the inside facade, which had a completely different character and also a completely different function, because we wanted the apartments, they have all double orientation, but let's say all the living orientation is towards the inner court. And this is the result. This is the entrance to the block. These entrances for us are pretty important, because they are the point where you divide the really public realm, so the street that you can see here, vis-a-vis the, let's say, more private inner courtyard. Private doesn't mean that they are closed, everybody can enter, but you're not invited to enter. No? And if you enter here, you have the feeling everybody can do it, but you have the feeling you enter more private situation, so you're not loud, you speak a little bit softer. And there is no real need. I mean, it's a kind of secondary network of communication, but there is no real need to use the courtyard. You can use the streets very very simply. These are the streets. This is the famous arcade. Here it was. The arcade went a little bit better. This is our arcade, by the way. And this is one of the courtyards, our courtyard, that is treated in a very simple way as a kind of landscape garden for the use, normally for the use of the tenants or the people owning the building, so children can play there, but also other people can come in. And this is this is the entrance from the station, so the arcade, you can see the square. Here you can see the building, this is our building with this very charming, rather regular facade. And I'm proud of it, not so much, well, also, of course, because it shows, I think, that a city extension also in the periphery can be done in a very urban way, but because the people who had to vote, because we are in Switzerland, so we have direct democracy, they had to vote for this project, and there was also a campaign against this Italian architect bringing Italy to Switzerland. The people voted in favor of it, otherwise we wouldn't have built it, very simple. And those who live here seem quite happy, which is the nicest thing that one can say as an architect or as an urban designer. Thank you very much.
Ask a first question to open it up. I'm really struck by the, you know, to pick these two projects of yours to show tonight, you know, for the sheer opposition of, you could say, one plan driven by the idea of an organizing grid, and on the other side, you know, which is a great, you could say, European model of modern urbanization, Cerdà's text and the sort of gridded extension of Barcelona, and at the other, your, with this project, the idea of the super block model. And the distinction between an interior and an exterior in a more classical or traditional form, and just the sheer opposition of those two mm-hmm. urban models. And I'm thinking about it and trying to reconcile that opposition that's operating across them. And one way to do it would be to say that in a way you're making an appeal for urban design today operating, you could say, almost as a form of curation, where rather than there being a set of strict principles that you could say drive across how projects at this scale need to be delivered, what both projects seem to be achieving is a way of finding coherence, you know, a word that you used several different ways tonight, through strategies that in fact might vary quite a lot from both the historical city and even from one project to the next, and these two projects you've just shown demonstrate that, but that your act is almost today a form of mediation more than anything, right? And the holding together of a larger field of deliberate differences, even the personalities of the architects involved or the materials that are being used. And I'm just wondering how you would respond to a question that would ask whether the curator today, like an editor, is almost a more viable model for what we used to call the planner than those former individuals who would always first write a kind of manifesto that would deliver a kind of constant uniformity across projects from one to another. Do you see yourself as a curator or a mediator more than a designer today?
Yes and no. I mean, it's a it's a very good or also a very mean question, whatever you want to say. No, because I think it's really the point of the problem, and what is clear is that we cannot. I mean, it's just impossible to achieve an urban design that is completely controlled and completely designed. It's just out of question nowadays in our political situation with the situations that we have. I would not. I do consider myself a curator when it then comes to, let's say, to architecture. I would not consider myself a curator in terms of urban design, because I think it's quite important that there is a pretty strict design. That's why we choose this strict, some say rigid, grid for the Novartis campus, and why for Richti we really defined it. In Richti it was a little bit more than that. Now the Novartis campus is, you're right. I mean it's this grid. We did the public spaces, and then we knew in between the lots, something would happen. I mean, Herzog Demmerer, of course, have not even accepted the height, and they're building a building that is that has a double height. So it's almost a skyscraper. So these things happen, and I suspected that they would happen, and so it's really that's. But it is really this grid. But this grid you have to design, no? And this grid should not change, or should change only because you change it as a designer. You should take this kind of responsibility. In fact, with Richti, we went a little bit further. No, we really tried to conceive it. I wouldn't say. Let me put it this way: Novartis is an act of curating. Richti, I would define it more like a big architecture, like one big architectural project on the scale of the city, done with different hands. But finally, in spite of the fact that we did not agree on every point, finally it is really, in a way, a collective project that we did in this group of architects. And if you look at it, it's also much. It's much more consistent than Novartis, and it's like really like a big piece of architecture with a very clear identity.
The striking bit with your presentation of Novartis, which is great to see after having so many of the architects in that aerial view come in and give their account, which makes it far more chaotic and incoherent than the legibility you can render it to the master plan, is actually that kind of coherence operates there also, despite some of those architects' strong opinions that they are doing only their project in the field. And I guess what I was thinking about was, you know, at a time like this in which a figure like, for example, in the art world, Hans-Ulrich Obrist is, you know, ranked now a number one leading figure in the art world, despite the fact that he's merely a curator and no longer a producer, is in a way to register, for me at least, it kind of records it's a reminder that role today really is a hugely valuable one in worlds where projects spin so many different directions or the interests get so complex and contested. I didn't mean it as a diminution of what planners do, but I'm just struck by that actually, both projects are an incredible demonstration of the importance of that role to make projects like this even possible at a certain level. And in a way, you're making a claim for the importance of that, even in the way you're writing the history of the city, which is so compelling that operation that was happening out here in this square that emerges in the 18th century was the definition of a few rules that then allowed very different builders to build each of the sides of this square and somehow mediate that together into that larger whole that you're showing. And in a way, what it is writing a completely different kind of history of the city also, and not just a history, which is quite amazing to see as the backdrop to the work today.
That's true, although the rules that were set up for Bedford Square were a little bit more strict than those.
But also equally sketchy. I mean, to this point, these buildings don't yet have an architect attached to them.
They're
an individual figure. You know, quite amazing. I'll open it up to the floor. Any other?
Thank you for the lecture. It was very interesting. I would like to ask two questions, and I will try to be short. The first one is related to the generation of the design itself. So I would guess my question would be, where do you find inspiration, or how the design is generated, or more like if the analysis informs your the generation of your design method. And the second question would be, as a counter response to the fundamentals of architecture that Kulhas was presenting this year in the Venice Biennale, what would you say that are the fundamentals of urban design?
Two pretty demanding questions, but good questions. I'll try to answer, although it's not too easy. The inspiration. I really believe that the knowledge of the history of urban design is a very important basis to in order to allow you to make choices. not because you have a kind of set of examples that you want then to follow, but you have a set of strategies that in a way have answered in the past problems that are not very far away from the problems that we have. So I think it's a big help. Then, of course, I mean, it's a design. Also, of course, at a certain moment, you take a decision, and it has always a degree of arbitrariness. But I think that this sufficient knowledge of the history of urban design can prevent you from making the most horrible mistakes, like doing, you know, structures that just don't work, and also preventing you from thinking that you are really original, which is, I think, a very big help, because a lot of architects and urban designers think they are very original just because they don't know the history and they're not aware that they are doing plagiarism, but without knowing it, of course, innocently. The second question, what was it? I forgot. The phone, I deliberately forgot it. The fundamentals. No, you know, it's probably the first time in my life that I agree with Rem, so it's quite embarrassing. And I also find it a little bit ironic that just the architect who has contributed most to the destruction of our discipline in terms of saying that there are no fundamentals, that buildings are not important, that only, you know, flows of information is important, that there is no urban design anymore because it's just about social connections, that he would, you know, do a biennale about fundamentals is quite astonishing. But I think it's great. I'm one of the very few people, I think, who at least people that I know who like the Biennale or who respect it very much, the Biennale, because you can argue if these fundamentals, if these elements are really important or not, or if they are complete, if something is missing, they are not on the same level. But bringing back architecture to some fundamental elements is very crucial. And coming back to urban design, yes, I think there are quite some fundamental things. And going back to Brett's question of the rules, let's say, I think, for instance, that in spite of the fact that Novartis and Richti are obviously quite different, but for instance, this very clear definition that we always try to make between public and private space, where things are built and the open space begins, is common to both. And I think that's one of the most important moves that you can do, not only defining this limit, which is defined by property, no? But also defining it in architectural and spatial terms. So that would be, in my view, a fundamental.
Yeah. Some examples which perhaps have inspired you from, say, the pre-war, pre-Second World War period and before. The planners of that period and the architects involved in urban design, it seems to be very rarely referred to public life. They referred instead to social life. And for instance, Henri Sellier is a very telling example. And I was wondering whether you think that this is true and whether there might have been, after the Second World War, a major change in that respect where the value in urban design shifted towards something such as public life and that it's actually introduced a rift between, on the one hand, the space of the street, and on the other, the spaces in the buildings and perhaps also in the courtyards, and perhaps with major implication for both disciplines, planning and architecture.
Mm. I get only difficult questions this evening. It's an interesting point. I think you're right. This distinction between social and public life. I was hesitating because I was thinking about CM8 and the core of the city and this idea, this quest for urbanity that came up almost immediately after the Athens Charter, actually, not trying to find what was missing, you know, in this functional city. Something. Everybody was agreeing that something was missing. They were talking about urbanity, but they didn't. I think that the real problem is that they were not clear, or only very few people were clear about how to do it. You know, how to create spaces that could be public spaces. Because yes, they created these beautiful community spaces for the small neighborhoods, all focused on the residential part, but not on the on public life. I suspect it has a lot to do with density, because if you don't have enough density, I mean, we are not speculators. In this case here, we had one of the aims of the competition was to find out what kind of density would be compatible with this place, and we went to this size because we thought that otherwise, with less people, we would not be able to make the shops, the restaurants, the cafes work, and we would not be able to create a square that is a square that is really a place where you can meet and say, okay, we meet at 12 on Richti-Platz.
Any more questions?
I don't know whether it's a question or a comment. I'll start from a comment and see if I can turn it into a question. I think what I've enjoyed about what you've showed is you know, the relationship between architecture and, let's say, urbanism, and that they are intertwined. So rather than having a plan and then the architecture comes, somehow they are curated, let's say, together. The lessons here are learned from European cities and are implemented or evolved for European cities. I was just trying to think how one can learn from this, when you know we are faced with rapid and large urbanisms, say in the Far East, where perhaps the lessons from the European city are not necessarily so immediately applicable, but there is this issue that actually speed of those developments force the architecture and the urbanism to come together in a way that here you are planning them or you are really bringing this along, whereas there it's inevitable that you have the architecture and the urbanism coming together. I think there is, and maybe this is the question, I think there is a scale difference between how architecture and urban design are brought together there in those large, let's say, rapid developments to here. And I'm wondering whether you agree. Or whether, maybe I'll just turn it now, you know, it seems to me that here the scale of architecture is actually quite different to the scale of the urban, even though they are inseparable. Whereas perhaps the scale of the architecture and the urban design in those developments are the same. Or maybe the architecture is the urban and the urban is the architecture. Do you agree?
I'm not sure that I agree, but also I'm not sure that I understood the question. Let's see. First of all, I agree, if that's one of your points, or let's say I would never propose such a model outside Europe. That's very clear, because this for me has a lot to do with what I presume, or what I hope to have, some insight into the way European people communicate together, the conventions of public life, let's say. And these conventions are different in different countries, it's very clearly. So I would never do this in China because it works differently. The speed for me is not... I don't think that the speed really changes things so dramatically, because Novartis went very slowly, or no, partially rapidly, then slowly in very different paces. This was very quick because they wanted to build and they were commercially successful. I think if you have a plan, or let's say, I think the challenge of a plan that really brings together urban design and architecture, and for me it brings together urban design and architecture in terms of space, in terms of the space that are created and the atmospheres that are created, should be done in such a way that it can be also developed very, very, very fast. I think if you have this plan, then speed is not such a big problem. You know, Barcelona was built pretty fast in this enormous plan of Cerdà, Berlin even faster, and somehow it worked.
I don't know. Maybe the word scale I'm using it wrongly. I felt that if you take the Novartis campus and you designed every single building in the same way, the scale of urban design and architecture would have become the same, meaning the whole thing is a piece of architecture.
Mm-hmm.
And that its success is that it keeps them different. If that same project repeated the same building as if it was a Hilbersheimer, let's say, city, it would have been something, it would have been that project rather than the Novartis project. And it keeps them different. Its success, it's dependent on that architectural grain, which perhaps in some of these other large developments that I'm kind of referring to, it the same rules may not apply, but I think it's interesting to learn from these models of relationship between architecture and urban design, and that whether they should not be kept different. In other words, that you don't take the same building and make the urban, mm-hmm. or take the urban and divide it into the same piece of architecture.
Yes, that's... I mean, that's a very interesting question. For instance, because we decided here to have the blocks done by different architects, but to have the whole block done by an architect. So this was completely different, for instance, from what has been done in Berlin, where they have divided the blocks into lots, not into fictions of lots, because because they belonged always to one person, but they were divided also between different architects, which I find as fake as saying you have to build a whole Richti out of bricks, because I say it has to be out of bricks. I mean, why? No. And but of course the next step would have been in this logic would have been to say, well, it's one owner. We have won the competition. We build everything. So and frankly, I'm not sure that I'm not self-confident enough. But I'm not sure if we would be able to do a really very beautiful building, it could be reproduced a few times. I think what you cannot do, or what I never like, is when one architect starts and then creates an artificial variety. That's for me almost never successful. But having the courage, I mean, this was very much criticized actually, the Richti, or let's say debated, because a lot of people said this kind of curatorial work is not possible today. It's much too authoritarian. It's too much a design. I'm wondering how far could you go with the idea that a piece of a not of course, we cannot build cities anymore. Cities are much too complex. They are collages. But to create a whole piece of a city in one with one hand, with one atmosphere, I think it's an interesting challenge, and I would at least consider it. You have to be very good to do it, however.
Thank you, everyone. Tomorrow night, Max Kalin, I think, is in here.